the Thanksgiving. Be like, glory to God, I have. Must have been some in that pecan pie, praise God. Let's talk about mind games. I want to give you five keys to winning at mind games. And I told you last week, I'm going to give you one word. One word that's going to set you free. It's like the cheat code of mind games, praise God. And I'll give you that at the end. Number one, are you ready for this? If you're ready, say amen. Amen. Number one, write this down. Focus on the positive. Focus on the positive. Now I need to help you out with something. These are not five things that God's going to do. These are five things that we're called to do in order to tap into what God's already done. Focus on the positive. I was reading a story this week about an Olympic hopeful, a young man who was, you know, from the time he started training, he was learning to throw the javelin. He had become very well. He was a prodigy, had natural born talent and a good work ethic. And he was working hard to try to become an Olympic javelin thrower. But during the process, as he was trying to prepare for the Olympic trials, and he had all these coaches and trainers that were helping him. Every day he would go out to practice, and his coach and his trainer would be out there with him, and they would say, hey, you're doing this wrong, or hey, you need to tweak this and do this different. And every single day they were pointing out the things that he was doing every day that they didn't like, that they felt like were holding him back from reaching his full potential. Well, the young man who was this world-class javelin thrower, what happened is, as he continued to work every day, he began to focus on all the things that he was doing wrong so he could change them. And the more he would focus on them, the worse he would get. And his trainers and his coaches even became frustrated, because they were like, my goodness, we're taking steps back. We're supposed to be getting ready for the Olympic trials, and we seem to be getting worse. And it was to the point where the young man was almost ready to quit, because he realized that every single day when he was working harder and harder, the harder he would work on his mistakes, the harder he would work at tweaking the things that weren't quite right, the worse he would seemingly get. And one day, one of his trainers had an epiphany. He said, you know what I'm going to do? He went and he got, this is back in the day now, so all you millennials don't know what I'm talking about. He got what we used to call a VHS tape, or a VCR tape, right? Y'all remember those, right? My goodness, glory to God. I was so happy when DVDs came out, so I didn't have to hit there and hit the rewind button, praise the Lord. He gave him a VHS tape of the best javelin thrower on the planet. And he said, I just want you to watch this guy. And so every day he would just watch this javelin throw, and he would watch his form, and he would watch it. How many of you know, when you want to know the right way to do it, watch the person who does it the best. And so he was seeing the right way, and what he began to focus on were not the things that were wrong, but the things that were right. He began to not focus on all the negative things that he was doing wrong. He began focusing on the positive things that the other guy had done right. And what happened is, then he would go out, and because he was focused on the positive things, he would begin to do it the right way. Amen. Why? Because he was focused on the positive. Do you know that life is the same way? Do you know that there have been several things in my life that I've wanted to challenge and overcome, certain things that I felt like were holding me back. And one in particular was, I used to coach football, and it was always just an accepted thing that when you coach football, you cussed. When you coached. I mean, that was just like a thing. I mean, honestly, if you didn't cuss, you weren't a good coach, I guess, praise God. But that was just the environment. I mean, I'm not proud of it, but that's what it was. And in the middle of my coaching career, I found Jesus, because he was lost. I used to tell everybody I found Jesus. How many know Jesus found me, praise God? But I found Jesus. And I realized, you know, I got to change the way I'm doing some things. And so I'll never forget this. True story. First year I was coaching, after I'd found Jesus, I would go to practice. I'd say, you know what? I got to make sure I mind my mouth today. Got to make sure I don't want anything to slip. I don't want to be a bad witness to Jesus. And I want to make sure that I set a good example. And I don't want to go in there and just cuss for no reason. Because, I mean, before I met Jesus, I would just cuss for no reason. You didn't cuss because you're mad. Just cussed all the time. Yeah. And just cuss words became adjectives, praise God. And so you know, it was like, you know, I would go to, and I would say, oh, I got to make sure that I don't do it. And then we'd get in the middle of practice every now and then. Somebody would do something just to make one of my players do something, just a bonehead decision. I would let one slip. You know, it wouldn't be a bad one, but it was still one. And then I'd go, my gosh, I might get back in my truck. I'd go home. I'd go, I did it again. I'm trying so hard. And you know what it seemed like? It seemed like the harder I tried not to, the harder it was not to. You know why? Because I was focused on the negative. And you know what a lot of us do is when we're playing, the enemy's playing these mind games on us, you know what we start focusing on? We start focusing on all the things that are wrong. All the things, oh, I wish I was a better giver. I wish I was a better husband. I I wish I was a better father. I wish I was a better Christian. I wish I was a better this. I wish I was a better that. I wish I was better. And then what happens is we begin focusing on all the negative things. And how many of you know whatever you focus on, you give power to? You begin to feed that negative thing all day long. And what happens in mind games is the enemy will always point out your flaws. And I want to help you out, help some of you out right here. The enemy won't even point out just your flaws. He'll try to convince you that you got flaws that you ain't got. Oh, you don't believe me? What did he tell Eve? He tried to convince Eve that she wasn't wise. You need to eat of this tree, because if you eat of this tree, you'll have wisdom. Because the reason God doesn't want you to eat of the tree, because you don't have something that you actually need. And you know, we say, that's so stupid. Why did she do that? God had told her not to. Can I tell you this? A lot of us, we eat of the wrong fruit every single day. Because the enemy convinces us that we don't have what we need. He gets us to focus on the negative. Well, if I would just do this. And so finally, we just get so overwhelmed. I remember this. I remember, back in my late teens and early 20s, I remember getting to a point where all I knew was religion. And I just got to a place where I was like, you know what? The harder I try, the worse I seem to get. The harder I try, the further away from God I seem to feel. And I feel like I'm not living up to expectations. And the worse I would do, the more guilt and condemnation I would feel. And the more guilt. Finally got to the point and said, you know what? I'm going for it. I'm going to bust hell wide open. I mean, there ain't a chance in heaven I'm ever going to get there. So I'm just going to bust hell wide open. I mean, my God, if I'm going to do it, I'm going to do it 100%. Praise God. You know why, though? Because I was so focused. The enemy had convinced me that I was so filthy and wretched and ragged that God, even the blood of Jesus, could never save me. You know why? Because I was focused on the negative. What you have to do when you are engaged in mind games with the enemy is you must focus on the positive. And watch this. Not your positive, his positive. It says, I need to take those things to the obedience of Christ. I can always focus on that. I'm not focused on all the things I do wrong. I'm focused on all the things he did right. Yes, sir. And that'll help you every time. You know what that young javelin thrower did? He studied the tape of the professional javelin. And you know what he did? He ended up becoming an Olympian. Because he stopped focusing on all the things he did wrong and started focusing on what was right. Just tap your neighbor and say, focus on the right thing. I love this. Let me ask you this question. Maybe this will hit home. Has your life ever improved when you focused on all the negative things around you? Has it? Then why do we do it? Positive minds produce positive lives. Negative minds produce negative lives. Every time. Positive minds are always full of faith. You know what negative minds are full of? Those mind games. Constantly bombarded by negative thoughts. But I love this because we have the decision maker on our side. We get the one who gets to determine what's positive and negative. His name's Jesus. And that's who we got to focus on. Number two, you ready for this? You got to affirm yourself. You got to affirm. You got to focus on the positive, but then you got to affirm yourself. I'm going to tell you something. We do not understand the power of affirmation in our culture. The Jewish culture understood this. Whenever a Jewish father, whenever his son got at the age of 30, you know what he would do? On his 30th birthday, he would take his son out in the middle of the marketplace. And this is what he would say. He'd say, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased. And do you know what that did? That let everybody in the marketplace know that now that son had the affirmation of his father so he could do business on his father's behalf. So what the father was saying is, from now on, I may not come to your booth to collect money. He might. But if he comes, I've affirmed him and he's a representation of me. You know, we don't get this in our culture. And I'll tell you something right now. There's been an attack for decades on fatherhood. An attack on fatherhood. Do you know why? It's not just because they're trying to remove the example. It's because the devil knows that if he can remove the affirmation, without affirmation, there's a lack of power. It's rampant. There's a reason. There's a reason why in the African-American population of our country, that men have been trying to be separated. The enemy's trying to separate men from their families. Because without affirmation, we are rendered powerless. Oh, y'all need a biblical example? Okay, I'll give you one. His name's Jesus. In Matthew 3, Jesus went on down to the River Jordan. Come on, somebody. He got baptized by John the Baptist. The Bible says the skies opened up and there was a loud voice from heaven. This is my son, Right there. You know what he did? He established identity. And then watch what he said. God said, in whom I'm well pleased. Amen. That Jewish tradition of affirming his son. Why do you think he did it at age 30? It was Jewish tradition. At age 30, the father would say, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased. He can do business. Yes, sir. He gets to act on my behalf. What did God say? This is my son named Jesus in whom I'm well pleased. He affirmed him. He said, in whom I'm well pleased. Can I tell you right now, not one single miracle had Jesus done before that moment. God the Father was not pleased in what he had done. God the Father was pleased in who he was. Jesus went on to perform miracles after he got affirmation. This is where the church misses it. We want to do miracles to get affirmation. We want to do miracles so we can feel validated. But Jesus never did a miracle to feel validated. He did a miracle because he'd already been validated. And let me tell you this. You're really not affirming yourself. You're reaffirming yourself. Because God has already affirmed you. If you don't believe me, read what he wrote about you. He said, you are now in Christ. There is no condemnation for you. He's well pleased with you. God doesn't look at you and go, Lord, have mercy. Bless their heart. That's my project. Y'all just pray for them. When God sees you, he sees you perfect in Christ Jesus. So he's affirmed us. The problem is we don't reaffirm ourselves. And I'm going to tell you something. You will need it. When Jesus, watch this. When Jesus got his affirmation, the Bible says the Holy Spirit led him into the wilderness where he fasted. The enemy came after him, and watch what the enemy did. The enemy did not attack anything but his affirmation. You know what he said? If you are. He never said, hey, Jesus, can you turn this into the stone into bread? He said, if you are who God said you are. In other words, if you were really affirmed. And you know what Jesus said? It is written. It is written. It is written. You know what he was doing? Reaffirming what the Father had already said. It is written. It is written. It is written. Some of y'all need to start having this conversation when the enemy shows up to play mind games with you on a Monday morning. You just need to start saying, excuse me, but it is written that yes, I am a child of God. It is written that I am a son or daughter of the King. It is written that I have become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So you can tempt me all you want to, devil, but I came to let you know that I have been affirmed by my Father. I am well pleasing to his sight. I am a child of God. If you believe that, go ahead and put your hands together and thank God for affirmation. And parents, you need to be affirming your children. I don't need my kids will not find out by social media who they are. I'm going to affirm them all day long. I'm going to tell them you are loved. You are loved by your mama. You're loved by your daddy. You're loved by your Jesus. Affirm their identity and who they are. Problem with most of us is that we're tangled up in our past. We're tangled up in what we came from or what we've come out of. And we refuse to, you know, to listen to the affirmation of God that declares the truth over your life. And you got to stop putting a butt where God says a yes. Some of y'all just need to get your butt out of it, praise God. Because God's told you you are perfect in his sight. Yeah, but get your butt out of it. Are you with me? You got to affirm yourself. And that's the problem with many of us is that we're not affirming. We know, yeah, I know what the Bible says, but I know what the Bible, yeah, you need to affirm. You need to declare it over your life every day. Well, can I just say this? What are you saying to yourself? Right. Well, Pastor, I don't speak to myself. That makes me crazy. No, you're crazy if you don't speak to yourself. Because everybody else is speaking over you. Can I tell you right now? I will never put my affirmation in your hands. There are people that are on social media every single day looking for affirmation. I will never put my affirmation in the hands of somebody. I will stand up in the mirror every day and say, my God, Lord, I know I don't look like a masterpiece, but I declare that I am in Jesus' name. I will affirm myself. I'm not going to put it in the hands of somebody else. Why? Because God's already affirmed me. And I know the enemy's going to come against you, but whenever he shows up and tries to tell you you aren't good enough, that's when you just say, nope, God said that there's a champion on the inside of me. Whenever the enemy tells me I don't have what it takes, that's when I'm going to say, nope, God said that his grace is sufficient for me. Whenever the enemy lies to me and says, you aren't going to make it, I'm going to say, nope, God has already spoken, and I am more than a conqueror. I'm an overcomer in Christ Jesus. I will win. I will not lose. I will live. I will not die, and declare the word of the Lord all the days of my life. Put that in your pipe, devil, and smoke it. That's why 1 John 4:4 says what it says. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. You got to speak positive things over your life. You got to make declarations over your life. Affirm what God says. Reaffirm the things that he's spoken over your life. Number three is this. Are you ready? It says, imagine God doing something good in your situation. Imagine. Imagination is not of the devil. But if it's not tied to the word of God, the devil will play there. Imagination, you've heard me say this in our last series in Super Dream Series. Imagination is the language of faith. Imagination is seeing things that aren't really there, aren't visible. And you got to imagine that God is working on your behalf. I didn't say you got to see it. You've got to be able to imagine it even when you don't see it. Man, there's so many of us that we only live by what we see. And the Bible says to just live by faith, not by sight. You know what faith is? Faith is me believing in something that I don't see. If I see it, I don't need faith for it. I've got to be able to imagine that God is working good things. Well, yeah, Pastor, but what if I don't see it? What if I don't feel like God's working on my behalf? I don't feel like I don't see God moving in this situation. Well, nobody ever said you would see it. Jesus never promised you'll see me working in it. Romans 8:28 doesn't say that he works all things for the good and you get to watch him while he does it. You don't know what God's up to. But he promises that he will work it together for your good. For those who love him are called according to his purpose. It never says you get to know what's going on, though. Here we pray all day long, Lord, grant me, I want a peace that surpasses understanding. And then we go to God and say, God, I want to understand exactly how you're doing it. Well, you just prayed for peace beyond understanding. If you want peace that surpasses understanding, you got to forfeit your ability to understand. Glory to God. You got to be able to know. You got to be able to imagine. Say, you know what? I don't see God working this thing, but I believe he is. What did Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego say? When they threw him in the fire, they said, hey, we believe the Lord thy God that we worship will deliver us. But even if we don't, we'll praise him anyway. And they threw him in the fire. They turned it up seven times. And you know what the Bible says? The Bible never says one time that they saw Jesus. Well, wait a minute, Pastor said there was a fourth man in the fire. Yeah, but look who it says saw him. Nebuchadnezzar saw him. It never says that the three Hebrew boys saw him. We want to see Jesus work. Well, sometimes Jesus is working and you don't get to see it. But what you need to know is he's always working. Just because he's silent doesn't mean he's still. And you may not see him, but watch this. The enemy sees him. The Hebrew boys didn't see him, but Nebuchadnezzar did. I just want to let somebody know, God's already working on your behalf. Jesus is in the middle of your mess, and you may not see him, but watch this. The enemy already knows it because he sees the fourth man in the fire. What have I got to do? I got to be able to imagine the good things of God. Jeremiah 29:11, what's God say? For I know the thoughts that I have towards you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace. And not evil, to give you a future and a hope. Isaiah 55:8-9. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, my ways are higher than yours, my thoughts are higher than yours. And I love this because he's going to say, my word that goes out from my mouth, it will not return to me empty. It cannot return to me void, but it will accomplish all that I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. A few weeks ago, I had lunch with a friend of mine, and he wanted to take me afterwards to see the house they were building, he and his family. And so he went and visited the house, and we show up on the lot, and we pull up, you know, in his vehicle, and we get out, just had lunch, so I had a little toothpick in my mouth, and kind of get out, and we're walking up, and there's these piles of dirt all out in the lot, and a couple of little pieces of equipment, and there's some boards that are, you know, some boards that are stakes that are sticking up out of the ground, and we walk up, and you know, you can see the holes where the where they had dug the, for the footings of the house, but they hadn't poured any concrete yet. So we walk up, and he's like, man, this is, you know, this is my house, this is what we're going to build, and this is what we're doing and everything, and he was so excited, and he turned around to me, and I was like, all right. Praise God. Best looking pile of dirt I've seen in 3 weeks. Praise the Lord. And he's going to, man, this is, and this over here, this is where my garage is going to be, man. It's going to be, you know, I got my garage here, and my man cave is going to be out of bed. This is where we're, you know, the master suite's over here. And he's showing me, walking out, ain't nothing but dirt. And I was going, man, that's good. And he was like, what do you think? I was like, man, I think it's going to be beautiful. Praise the Lord. But how many of you know I wasn't nearly as excited as he was? You know why? Because I hadn't seen what he had seen. See, I hadn't seen the drawings or the blueprint. All I saw was the work in progress. All I saw was dirt and mud. But he had seen something greater. And so his excitement, I was like, man, his junker's excited. You know why he's excited? Because he knows. He's imagining what it's going to look like as a finished work. And here I am looking at it going, oh, well, that's good, man. That's going to be nice. You know, call me in a few months when you get a thing up, and I'll come watch some football with you. Can I tell you right now, though, how many of us are standing there with Jesus, and Jesus is saying, look at what I'm building you right now. I'm building you a house, and this is where your man cave's going to be, and this is where, my God, your she shack's going to be, and this is where your kitchen with the island's going to be, and this is your master suite. And we're all sitting there, you know what we're doing? We're just looking at it saying, I don't see anything but mud. I don't see anything but concrete. I don't see anything but dirt. But Jesus is saying, no, well, you're missing the point. I'm showing you something, a greater future. I'm showing you a preferred hope. I'm showing you a greater picture, and you got to start looking at what you see and stop looking at what you need to. My goodness. You got to imagine that God is working even when you don't see it. Amen. Brings me to number four. You ready for this? You got to trust. Trust God in all things. See, first I got to imagine that God's working. Then I got to trust that he is. That's a big one. It's a big one. This is where many of us struggle. This is where the rubber meets the road. Because I believe that God is with me always. I believe that God is for me, not against me. But buddy, when things get tough, and I got to trust that. Like, it's easy to declare it on Sunday. It's easy for you to shout me down when I yell it in here. But in the middle of your Wednesday, can you trust that God is doing something good? You know, I woke up yesterday morning, I walked outside, and it was overcast. And you know, when I was walking in my truck, coming, getting in the vehicle to come to church, and I looked up, all I saw was clouds. But how many of you know that not one time did I go, oh my God, oh no, the sun is not out. The world may be ending because I don't see the sun. Because without the sun, the earth's going to end. And oh my God, I don't see the sun. What am I going to do? The sun, what? I don't know if the sun's real. All I see is clouds. I'm not real sure the sun's up there. Do you know that that didn't happen yesterday? Do you know why that didn't happen yesterday? Because I trusted that even though there was a cloud cover, that the sun was still in the sky. Well, how many of us have a cloudy day? Well, I don't really know if God's still with me. Glory to God, what am I going to do? I'm not sure if God's in this. I don't see God. I don't know if God's there. You got to trust. You gotta get in a place to go, you know what? I don't know. I see all the stuff around me. I see the stuff I'm going through. I hear the bad report. I'm fighting, wading through the arguments, navigating the relationship, battling through the tough financial season I'm in. But I'm believing that somewhere on the other side of those clouds, somewhere on the other side of this difficulty, there's a glory. Somewhere on the other side of this cloud, there's a sun shining. You know what that's called? Trusting. It's called trusting in God. It's called declaring. I love Isaiah 26:3. It says, because the prophet of God is telling God, he's saying, this is what's going to happen to the man of God that puts his trust in you. Watch this. You will keep him in perfect peace. Because his mind is on you, God. Because he trusts in you. You know what? You know how to get peace? So you think peace is when the storm leaves. No. Peace is when you can stand in the middle of the storm and know that I may not see God, but God's still here. Because if the only time I have peace is when there's an absence of a storm, the moment a storm shows up, my peace leaves. But when I can have peace in the middle of a storm, because I know the one that controls the storm, I know the one that can speak to the storm, I know the one that who's going to be in my boat no matter if the storm shows up or not, then I'm going to declare that no matter what storm comes my way, everything's going to be all right. Huh? That's my Bob Marley revelation right there. Every little thing is going to be all right. That's trust in God. You got to trust. Trust God in everything. The last one is this. Number five is you got to hope for the best. I'm going to deal with this right here because sometimes we say, oh, you got to hope for the best. That's like this fleeting wish. Oh, well, when all else fails, just hope for the best. Wish that something good will happen. Hope that, you know, everything's not destroyed. No, that's not the kind of hope I'm talking about. Because the Bible says that hope is the substance. It's the beginning of faith. It's the beginning. That's where your faith comes from. You can't have faith without hope. Hope initiates your faith. What is this? The substance of things hoped for. And evidence of things unseen. So I've got to have hope before I have faith. I've got to be able to hope for the best, even if what I'm looking at appears to be the worst. It's the language of faith. The best way to live our life is from a faith-initiated view of tomorrow. If you only think that things are going to get worse, then you're right. But if you believe that things will get better, you're right too. The person that believes that tomorrow is worse and the person that believes tomorrow is better, they're both right. Because what are you putting your hope in? And I'm going to tell you something. Hope is not this wishful thinking. Hope is substantial. Hope initiates faith, and faith is substantiated by good works. That's what he says. Faith without works is dead. So I can tell where your hope lies by your actions. I can tell if you got faith based on how you're preparing right now. You can tell me all day long you're waiting for Boaz. But if you ain't never wearing no makeup, you ain't got much hope. Why? Because my faith is backed up by my actions. Because if I really am hoping for the best, then I'm going to be preparing for it. Well, hope for the best, but prepare for the worst. Well, if I'm hoping for the best, why do I need to prepare for the worst? I'm either going to trust God or I'm not. I'm not saying you don't. I'm not saying you don't. You know, finances. I'm not saying you don't have savings for in case something happens. I'm not saying that. But I'm not saying be stupid. But my God, we gotta. I'm amazed at how many Christians live such boring lives. Because we have calculated every single thing to the point where there is no trusting. I don't have to trust God if I trust my processes. I'm going to be honest with you. How can you follow Jesus and have a plan B, C, and D? I mean, are you going to be like Peter? And the moment it didn't work out the way you thought it was going to work out with Jesus, you're just going to go back to what you used to go back to? Because Jesus is just going to show up and call you away from that again. And we undermine our faith by coming up with all the things that we can do in case the Jesus doesn't work out. And that's faithless. It's faithless. Like, if I'm going to believe, I'm going to believe. And, you know, I mean, that's a blessing and a curse sometimes. I'm all in one way or the other. Caleb, tell you, many of you know it. There's no middle of the road. If I'm in, I'm in. If I'm not, I'm not. And It is what it is. But you know what? When it comes to Jesus, man, I think that's the way you got to do it. I mean, you know, Revelation talks about being lukewarm. And like, I'm just not in a place where I'm okay with trusting Jesus with this part of my life, but not this part of my life. It either is or it's not. He either works or he doesn't. His word's true or it's not. I mean, at some point, you got to trust him. I had a conversation with a friend a few months ago, and I was, hey, man, how's your spiritual life going? Well, it's going good. I was like, how about you trusting God with your finances? Because that had been an issue. Well, I'm not there yet. So you trust God with your marriage, but not your money. You're telling me you trust God with your kids, but not your... So what's more important to you? I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like, you can't forget the fallbacks. Hope for the best. Just say, you know what, God? And you know what? And this is what I tell God all the time, every single time. God, I really don't know how you're going to do this. I don't, but I'm hoping. I'm hoping for the best. I'm believing. That's what I'm going to do. So that's five. Throw them up on the screen for me, guys. First thing we got to do is we got to focus on the positive. We got to affirm ourselves. Stop waiting for everybody else to affirm you. Then we got to imagine God is doing something good. We got to trust God in all things. And we got to hope for the best. There's your five things for mind games. But when you do this, when you focus on the positive, when you affirm yourself, when you imagine God doing good, when you trust God in all things, and when you hope for the best, do you know what comes out of that? I'll give you a hint. Faith. Faith. That's it. Well, how do I win the mind game? Here's how you win the mind game: with faith. With faith. By trusting in Him. And let me tell you something. That's how I want to close. Faith is not this theoretical idea. It's not this ideology of this thing that's kind of out there and it's all, I don't really know, faith kind of, it's all over the place. It's this, no, that's not faith. Faith must be functional. Faith is for your everyday life. My God, there's a lion on the screen. You must have faith like a lion, praise God. Hey, I shared this with the church, I don't know, a couple years ago, I guess. I really believe, Didier, I don't know how it is in your community. I don't know how it is in the African-American community, but can I tell you right now that in the white people's world, the biggest thing.
Let the sound of worship be released from your lips tonight. Come on, raise it now. Oh, that's good, y'all. Raise it.
Special occasions. On special occasions, you get to bring out the fine china. But you know, our faith is a lot like that. We get our faith in Jesus and we put it on display. And the only time we bring it out is when we need to impress somebody. And so we bring out the china and and then we put it back up. See, if I had a china cabinet, and I don't, but if my china cabinet had china in it, and it doesn't, but you came to my house for a special occasion, Patrick, we might break out the fine china. But if you come to my house on Tuesday, when we eating hot dogs, here's what you're going to eat off of. If we're in a good season of life, you eating off red plastic with the dividers in it. So your baked beans don't mix up with your butter beans. I would do that for you. Now, if Jamel came over, we just going to have a flat white paper plate. Ain't got no divider or nothing. It's all of it run together, glory to God. It's all going to end up in the same place anyway. Right? Because paper plates may not be as impressive, but they're functional. And many of us have a china plate faith that we only bring it out when we need to impress somebody. Oh, I'll tell you about my Jesus in my social media debate. Or I'll pull it out when I gotta have it, when I'm out of everything else. But I don't want china cabinet faith. I want paper plate faith that I can use every single day. I'm not going to pull my faith out on Easter and Christmas. I don't pull my faith out once a week on Sunday. No, it's something that I use every single day because it's functional. If your faith is not functional, it's not faith. See, your faith is what helps you win the everyday battle between your ears. It's my trusting in God. It's my focusing on His finished work, not my incompletion. It's me standing in a place of affirmation saying, you know what? I don't feel like it today, but I'm still it. I don't look like a child of God, but I'm still a child of God. I don't feel like a child of God, but I'm still a child of God. And affirming myself. It's getting to a place where, you know what? I don't see you working, but I'm imagining that you are. And then once I imagine, I'm going to trust that you are. And in that whole process, I'm just going to hope. I'm going to hope for the best. I'm not hoping for the best because I need to wish something into existence. I'm hoping for the best because His word tells me that He works it for my good. And when my hope gets stirred, my faith is built up. And when my faith gets built up, my actions correspond to my faith. And then I begin looking like the Christian that I already am. Stand to your feet and dismiss you. Society, to be honest with you, even in the church world, I would hear people say, fake it till you make it. You ever heard that?
Yes,
sir. You ever said that? Yeah. You ever done that? Fake it till you make it. But what if we, instead of fake it till we make it, what if we faith it till we make it? In other words, I'm not going to wait till I see it to say it. But I'm going to live in a place of hope and expectation that I'm going to believe it. And I'm going to live like it. Do you know why the Bible calls us a peculiar people? Right after He tells us that we walk by faith, not by sight. It's because your life that you're living is a reflection, not on the circumstances that you're in, but the promises that He has in store for you. So I don't live my life according to the season that I'm walking through. I live my life according to the promises He's declared over me. So it looks peculiar to you when I'm struggling to make ends meet, but I'm declaring that I'm debt free. It makes no sense to you when I'm declaring that I'm raising children of God and I got a prodigal out in the world somewhere that I don't even talk to. It makes no sense to the world when my marriage looks like it's falling apart, but I'm still edifying him while he undermines everything I do to try to hold this marriage together. It's me walking around saying I'm healed by the stripes of Jesus, even though the doctor's report said otherwise. Do you know what I'm doing? I'm not faking it. I'm faithing it. I'm not pretending like something. I don't pretend like anything. It's not Mr. Rogers' neighborhood. But I'm faithing it. Because I believe it. Because I don't live by me. I don't live by what I experience. I live by what He says. And that's the key to mind games. And if we'll begin to shift our thinking and declare, you know what? how it's going to work out, God. I don't know what it's going to take. I don't know what it's going to look like. Because I'm going to tell you something. There have been a lot of times where I lost battles, and I thought I'd lost a war. No, it was just a setup. And there's sometimes that the enemy is good, and he takes things that he shouldn't get, and I go, that ain't going to work. But can I tell you right now, when you walk by faith, do you know what happens? And this, I'm believing this. I've been declaring this over my life, over my wife's life, over my kids. I've been declaring this, that there will be a day where the enemy will declare the same thing about me and my family that he did about Jesus. If I would have only known what it was going to do, I'd have never done what I was doing. Throw your hands up to heaven right now. Let me pray over you. I'm declaring right now for some of you a measure of faith like you've never had before. Some of you, listen, some of you are going to walk out of here and you're going to be like, my goodness, something's happened. And you're going to have faith that's attached to your spinal cord. You're going to begin walking in a level of expectation like you never have before. Walking upright with your head held high going, I don't even know what it is, but I'm just believing God for good stuff. And some of you are not even going to know why. But I'll tell you why. It's your spirit man's been awoken to something that's greater than you've ever known before. Lord, I just thank you right now that everyone in the sound of my voice, watching online, everyone in this building, is operating at a place of faith. Declaring that what we see is not the end game. What you say is. That we walk by faith, not by what we're struggling with or what we're going through, what we see around us. But that every step that we take, every single thing that we're going through, everything that we're facing, that you have ordered our steps. And that we will be victorious in Christ Jesus. Lord, I thank you that we will win the mind games. That every time the enemy attacks us, we will stand victorious. That we have been given the mind of Christ. That we are not swaying to and fro. We're not believing one thing one day and something the next. But we are rooted deeply in the trust that we have in you, Christ Jesus. And your finished work of the cross. The thing that we bring everything captive unto. And for that, Lord, we give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise. In Jesus' mighty name. Put your hands together if you're thankful for faith. Come on. If you love Jesus, let him know at one time. Love you. God bless you. Have a great rest of your day. See you next Sunday.